Hello and welcome to Contact. I'm Gloria Creighton, and we're here once again at lovely Anderson's restaurant overlooking Falls Creek. My guest on today's show is a woman who for many years has been a very important part of this city's musical theater scene. Producer, singer, and teacher, Pat Waldron.
Hi.
Welcome, Pat.
Thank you.
So, you know, you've been part of the scene for so many years, I was expecting someone older.
Well, thanks for
you're
that.
You're still quite young.
Yes, well, makeup does wonders.
I doubt that it's all makeup.
Yeah.
I think it'll be interesting for our viewing audience to meet the woman who was behind that wonderful hit musical, Peter Pan.
Well, it was quite an adventure. It was
quite an undertaking.
Yes, it was probably, well, I think it was one of the largest commercial undertakings for musical theater in this town, and we were really happy to say that we won 4 Jessie Awards for the show.
Wonderful,
and,
congratulations.
It showed a lot of support from the local theatrical community, and we took the show on tour to Seattle and Spokane as well. So it was kind of a reverse, starting a show here from scratch and then touring it to other parts.
That's right, Pat. Actually, you did the show originally in May, and then you ran it in November. It was sold out.
That's right.
And then you had someone come and ask you to go to the States.
Yes, we were offered a U.S. national tour, so
isn't
we were
nice?
Really thrilled. And I consider it a great compliment. And all Canadian talent except for one of the leads.
Right. So, and as I said, you were the brains and the talent behind it.
Well, I started
one
the ball
woman.
Rolling.
How did you do it?
Well, it was actually a lot of people working together. Yeah. And I have some very good technical people. I had some partners I brought in, and they all contributed their areas of expertise. And we raised the money locally from local investors. And
were you on the phone for hours, phoning people?
Yes, quite a bit. And I think I was so enthused that some of them just caught fire, and they told one another, and that's how it all started.
Because you raised a lot of money, so you must have really gotten people's trust or gotten them excited about the idea.
I think as far as musical theater goes, I've produced 12 shows in total over the years at Summit Gateway Theater. They started out from the amateur ranks and became semi-professional and then finally professional. So my first professional show was at the Vancouver Playhouse. We did a production called Chicago.
Right.
And so that started it.
So you had a good track record, so people didn't mind betting on you, putting the money
down. A lot of belief in the talent here in Vancouver. There's
lots of
it.
That's great, Pat. Yeah. Why Peter Pan?
Well, it sort of was always a fantasy, and I felt that creating some special effects with the flying and so on would be very exciting, and it's a classic story, and I think I like family product. I think it's nice to have something where the whole family can come to see the show, and at affordable prices. You know, we didn't, we sort of cater to a children's price and an adult price.
Now, this was an all-professional cast.
It was.
Right, this time.
Mm-hmm.
And all-Canadian.
All-Canadian.
Which is wonderful, Canada.
Except for Kathy Rigby, who played
the American lead. And you were saying off-air that you have to usually have an American lead for the bookers. And
well, yes, or in her case, flying is quite a unique thing to do. And the Foys came up and put up the rigging. And Kathy, as you know, was a gymnast of note. And so she had the strength to add lots of zest to that flying. It was quite risky, and some people don't look terrific flying. They look awkward, you know.
It's not the easiest thing to do.
Sets and things.
Yeah.
So she was very good. Correct. And she sings like a dream, too.
Yeah.
So.
Can you tell us some of the locals that were in it?
Well, pretty well all the local talent auditioned. We had over 300 people auditioning, including children. And we had to pick a set of pirates from that. And so every dancer, every singer had a chance to audition.
Who was Captain Hook?
Captain Hook was Long John Baldry.
Is that right?
And he was a bit of a long shot because he'd done, you know, one-night gigs with his guitar. But he really adored doing the role, and the more he did it, the better he got. And I think he had a lot of fun. He'll never forget playing Captain Hook.
Great. Let's talk about some of the other musicals, some of the old classics that you've done.
We've done lots of musicals. We've done Hello, Dolly, and we've done Guys and Dolls, and Chicago, as I mentioned, and let's see what else.
Anne of Green Gables.
Anne of Green Gables, yes. At Gateway, Wizard of Oz, Gypsy, Annie. We did a lot at Gateway. I approached them actually before it even opened and suggested they might want to back the shows, and we would provide the product. And they thought that was a good idea, so we provided their Christmas musicals for the first 4 years of its life, and we developed quite a good clientele for them.
Is Gateway a good venue for
musical
theater?
It's a beautiful theater,
is it?
A gorgeous theater.
Particularly for musical theater.
Yes.
You need a larger space, don't you?
Yes, that's right, although it has a very intimate feel. It's about the same size as the Playhouse, seating-wise. Yeah. So.
And for many years you were at the Metro
Theater, and way back in the old days we started out at the Lord Byng High School Gymnasium with Knox Operatic Society, so that really ages me. And Knox Operatic Society turned into Dunbar Musical Theater, and Dunbar Musical Theater reopened Theater Under the Stars.
So you were there right at the beginning, Pat.
Yes, yeah. Doing it all, making the coffee, PR, sweeping, you name it.
Yeah. Performing, producing, directing.
The whole thing.
Well, what's happening to Metro Theater now? Is it
well, Metro is still going strong. It provides a season every year of 7 plays and 1 musical, and they've just done a big renovation, and it consists of a lot of amateur people pulling together, working hard.
Let's get back to your other musicals. As you said, Peter Pan was all professional cast, but a lot of your other musicals were amateur.
They're called
semi-pro.
We call them semi-pro because our philosophy was to hire professional directors who would create a learning experience for the amateur. And so they'd be inspired to pull up their standards and work harder and learn the craft. It's quite a unique thing, musical theater, because you need to be skilled in all three areas of singing, dancing, and acting.
That's right.
And actually, that's why I established my singing, dancing, and acting studio.
Right.
So when I auditioned people, I realized some of them were strong singers, but really poor acting and, you know, couldn't move. So everybody has stronger skills in certain areas.
Yeah. Do you find if someone's got a natural talent, say, as an actor, that they have a bit of a talent for singing and dancing? Or
I think everybody has a terrific potential. You know, a lot of it's selling it. A lot of it's learning how to smile, and if you make a mistake, keep smiling and nobody notices. I shouldn't say that too often, but anyway, it works sometimes. And there are some people who are more talented than others, of course. And you just, with the studio, we encourage right beginners right through to advanced courses that are workshops for people to hone their craft, you know, really improve their skills.
Yeah. What is the amateur talent like in the city?
Excellent.
Do we have a lot of good
talent? It doesn't
have
a lot of opportunity for, there aren't a lot of outlets anymore. There used to be quite a few, actually. They had Mussock in the old days from the university, where Grace McDonald's stomping grounds. And people like Jeff Hislop and Ruth Nickel and Brent Carver, they all sort of got their basics from those groups.
So what is happening now?
It's actually having a resurgence. We're the only studio that focuses on musical theater. Others do a lot of film, and some do straight acting and so on, or just dance.
Yeah.
But we've tried to create all three.
Great. Great. And so these amateurs, a lot of them go on to become professionals?
A lot of them have, yes. A lot of people through the studio have gone on to be in the company of Les Mis and Phantom of the Opera, including some younger children. And others have gone on to film and so on. So we've created quite a good core here.
You've got Jeff Hislop was involved with
Jeff Hislop directed and choreographed Peter Pan, as well as 6 Women with Brain Death or Expiring Minds Want to Know.
Now, what was that all about? I missed that, unfortunately, but I've heard about
it. It's a crazy musical. It's very much an ensemble piece.
Is that the Arts Club?
Yes, it was. We ran it for 3 months. We also took it to Toronto, and it ran for 5 months in Edmonton at a Stage West Dinner Theatre. And it was, people either loved it or they were sort of puzzled by it, but they came back. We found people came back 5 or 6 times to see the show.
What inspired you to do this one, Pat?
Well, actually, one of my backers heard about the property, and we flew down to see it in L.A., and Jeff Hislop came with us. And it's based on headlines from the National Enquirer, and it's a spoof, and it's very outrageous, and it's a lot of fun, and we just thought it was quite different. And it's not really women's issues, but it has a woman's perspective on things. And there's a TV addict, and there's a song called Rambi. And it was sort of a mixture of Rambo and Bambi and Disney, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah. Well, it really worked because it was a hit, very popular.
Yeah, we might bring it back again, you never know.
Great. Well, I'll catch it this time for sure now that I've met the producer.
Good.
What's it like being a producer in this city?
Well,
it's
sometimes quite frustrating. It's a lot of hard work, and I think anybody producing really needs a background in theater from the beginning. But it's also very rewarding when you see the results of just, you have to be persistent, I think, actually, you know, and it works eventually.
Do you find it tougher being a woman, a female producer?
Sometimes. I think, yes, it is a man's world in many ways, but there's also a lot of respect out there if you show that you can, you've got the stuff to do it. Right.
Are we providing a lot of venues for our local talent, our local
I wouldn't
producers?
Say a lot, no. There's a lot of professional, smaller groups in town, the Fire Hall and everything, do a lot of wonderful work. I think generally, though, sadly, a lot of our talented people get a little frustrated because of the lack of work, and they go to Toronto or to the States.
Do you see this changing?
I hope so. I'm going to try my darndest.
Right. Well, you're doing your bit anyway, aren't
you?
Yeah,
I'm trying, for sure.
Let's go back a bit with you, Pat. You come from a theater family.
Well, my father was a professional, a theater person in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, and he did very well. There was a lot of theater then and a lot of radio, and he wrote his own scripts, and the whole family took part in the shows on the radio. He had a sitcom, what they call nowadays. He was on The Littlest Hobo when it first came out, and he was in the first festival, and he was a real inspiration. My dad was in Theatre Under the Stars for many years. So,
actually, you know what we're going to do right now, Pat? We're going to take a little while and look at you in action at your studio.
Oh, great.
Or not necessarily you, but perhaps some of your students.
Children taking part.
Children's.
Sure.
Okay, can we do that?
Sure.
Charlie Brown, is Lucy going to pitch again? Because if she does, I quit. You know what she does? She's always calling me out for conferences on the mountain. I go out there for a secret conference on the mountain, and you know what she does? She kisses me on the nose!
Once again, for Contact, I'm Gloria Creighton, and we've just been looking at Pat Waldron's students at Singing, Dancing, and Acting Studio. Pat, that was fun.
Well, the children are getting ready for a showcase at the Arts Club. We have 10-week sessions, and they're doing You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. So we put them through their paces, all right. And
they look like they're loving it.
Sing out and move their feet in time to the music. That's quite a challenge to do all of it at once. Yeah, they have a good time.
They look fairly young.
We have a class called Song and Dance, and they're little children from 3 to 5. Then the mothers can bring their little children and do a mother and taught tap class. Then we have our children's musical theater, and they're 8 to 10. So we cover all the ages. And we even have a Golden Girls class, where ladies from 45 and over can sing and dance, fulfill those fantasies.
So do you use any of the old musicals excerpts for these?
Yes,
for this
we
class,
do. Yeah, we select all the Broadway, in quotes, Broadway musicals. Yeah.
So your studio, Singing, Dancing, and Acting is open to the public?
It definitely is.
So anyone can phone
they
up
can
and
just come along
sign
and
up?
Ask us about any of the courses, and we'll be happy to register them.
Yeah. And you've got all levels from beginner to?
Everything that we can think of that we cover.
How about workshops? Do you workshops?
Yes, we do workshops. We're just starting this spring, actually, to do workshops right in the studio and create a little theater space and perhaps take some of them to the Fringe Festival. I'm not sure how that's going to work.
So your students actually get a chance to perform?
Definitely. They always do. We have a showcase at the end of every session.
So this keeps you pretty busy,
your
studio.
Yes, I love it very much.
And you got your producing, and I know that you also coach.
Yes, I do a lot of vocal coaching right now.
Yeah.
And that's satisfying, too. A lot of people come to me, they're very vulnerable when they come to singing. They feel exposed. It would be like me going to dancing lessons, you know, when you have to kind of put yourself on the line. But I try to send them out with a little more confidence, and they seem to enjoy it.
You've got a background in singing. What was your training, Pat?
Well, I trained with the Royal Conservatory of Music to grade 9, and then I was in the opera course one season way back when, and I've been performing in lots of musicals. I was in Charlottetown last summer doing Anne of Green Gables.
That's right.
Rachel Lind.
What was that like?
Oh, that was quite a challenge. 8 shows a week and
good heavens.
Heavy costumes, and it was very hot, but it was great.
Yeah. You were telling me off camera that you rode everywhere in a little bike with
your
basket.
Going back in time, and I had to walk or ride my bike, so I actually was quite fit when I finally came home.
Great. So, well, how did your family? I know you've just recently had a grandchild.
Yes.
Can we say that?
Yes, you sure can. Yes, my daughter, actually, I got back September 8th, and she had a little boy September 11th, so she held on for me.
Great.
I was thrilled.
Yeah, so
they missed me. I think it was a bit long, but I enjoyed the experience.
Do you, you're not really performing all the time now, are you?
No.
Basically
no,
running the studio
I just
and
don't
teaching.
Have the time. But
do you get the itch sometimes?
Call? Yes. Yeah. I'm a ham at heart. I just love it. Yeah.
Do you, you've also done a bit of film and commercial work.
Yes, I do a few commercials here and there, too. You sometimes see my face popping up on some ads. So they like the comedic touch sometimes, so.
Right. Let's go back a bit, Pat. We were talking about your dad in the early days of theater in Vancouver.
Yeah.
How has the scene changed now? I know there's a lot of musical theater in those days. Is there less now, or is
I think musicals are harder to do now because they're very expensive.
Yeah.
When we first started out, a musical would cost around $10,000. Now they're about $110,000. The same caliber of amateur kind of musical, and you have a few houses now are without the unions, and you have union houses, then it's a little more expensive. Mind you, you know, you get more professional work as well. But so it's a little more difficult to put on, you know, musicals where there's 35 people involved. I'm going to attempt to do Where's Charlie this summer at Metro, and that'll be a cast of about 18. And that's about as because I want to go.
That's a small scale, is it, for a musical?
No, 18? That's about an average.
Is it average? Okay.
Yeah, yeah. 35, or your music man's usually got about 35 in it, and the Hello Dolly, musicals like that.
Right. How about audiences? What kind of audiences do you attract?
Well, we tend to attract, as I said, family audiences. Mind you, shows like Chicago and Six Women, we attracted a different group.
Right.
And it's nice to be able to do a variety. But, you know, when you don't have your own theater, it's a little difficult. Sometimes you have to fit in with everybody else's schedule. But I would say that there's a good core of audiences out there. In fact, I think your larger musicals that stayed for many months probably created a bit of interest from people and encouraged them to come out to more. I think there's a bit of controversy about that, but I think it did make them aware.
How about competition now with the movie industry and the video bit?
I think they're pretty different.
Yeah.
You know, they're quite separated. it's a totally different sort of group of people involved.
Do you find, though, that a lot of families, and nowadays both parents work, the economy is difficult, and people say that their weekends they're tired and it's easier to plop a video into the machine?
That could be,
but you know what?
Are you losing audiences to the videos?
No, I don't think so.
No? I think that actually, you know, traditionally during recessional times, Broadway musicals seem to be more popular. I think people want to go and escape. And I think, as a matter of fact, I think there's an upward trend right now, in New York anyway. I don't know about everywhere else. But.
You were saying, speaking of New York, you were saying that a lot of people, to get back to Peter Pan, thought that it had come from New York.
A lot of local Vancouver people, well, it's a sort of a underhanded compliment. It suggested to me they felt that we couldn't produce that kind of caliber here, but of course we know we can. And we have a lot of talent, not only performers, but technical people, stage managers, designers. There's all sorts of really wonderful people here. And I say, let's give them some work.
Okay, so you're working on that. Are you funded? Do you get any kind of funding to support this wonderful work you're doing?
Government funding?
Yeah.
No. The Singing, Dancing, and Acting Studio
is eligible. Your nonprofit society?
That's a nonprofit society. That's separate. Okay. As a producer, no. No, it's mostly individuals.
Corporate funding. So that's an area that you could explore for your studio, though.
Yes, certainly the grants. We should be eligible for some grants. We want to do some summer programs for children who, perhaps from the inner city, who are underprivileged, and we're looking into those kinds of things.
Because musical theater is such a magical experience.
Creates a lot of joy. Sure, I've had fun all my life, I'll tell you.
Yeah. You've got a project. Or a dream.
Yes.
Can we talk about that? A musical that you would like to do.
I do. I have a musical that I'm really hoping to launch. And maybe one of these days I'll be able to tell you that it's all definite. But so far, I'm not sure yet.
Oh, okay.
But
we're
hopeful.
We're talking about, I think, two different things. There's another one that we can talk about.
Yes, yes. Oh, yes.
An old classic.
There's an old classic I've always loved, Wuthering Heights. And I saw they're just reviving another version of it in the movies. And I really believe it would make an excellent musical. And so I'd like to commission a well-known composer to write the music for it and create a script. And I have a feeling that it could do very, very well. So I'm out hunting around.
So you're out hunting any for money? Any
sure,
would-be
anything.
Sponsors out there?
For sure, yes. I think it could be just as successful as a Phantom if it's handled properly, of course. I mean, that's easy to say, but it takes a lot to write a script. But still, it's got that potential, for sure.
I know they say now that Vancouver is the Hollywood North, and the movie industry is booming here and so on. Do you see the same thing happening with theater? Or do you think there's a competition that as one grows, one will die?
I don't think so, no. I think it's different people that it attracts. There's lots of people. I think that there are going to be new theaters built here in several areas, so fill them. Yes, well, I've certainly heard the rumors about Garth Drabinsky building a theater here, and University is planning a theater, and I think there's a couple of venues that are going to be forthcoming.
So a lot of it is space, is it not, Pat, for local people?
That's right, and space that's affordable. Renting the Queenie is very expensive, and it's the only big theater in town if you do a big musical. So. And it's also booked a lot, so it's hard to get.
And it's worked for our local actors. Traditionally, actors, dancers, artists do not make a lot of money.
No.
And it's such an important part of our culture, for
That's
society.
Right. That's right.
It brings such joy to people's lives. What can we do to change this?
Well, I think we can try to create more product so that people become more aware and just keep pounding the pavement for interested people that want to get involved, maybe on the financial end of it.
Yeah. Sometimes
encourage them.
Sorry, go ahead.
No, I just said to encourage them.
Right. Sometimes it's difficult, though, say for an actor who's got to go out and take a waitering job or, you know, an office job to exist, so it's hard to pound the pavement. It's sort of a catch-22 situation.
True. I think you just, in this business, you do it because you love it and you take your, you know, problems with it and just keep plugging.
So you sort of starve and keep
That's
at
right.
it.
That's right. That's all part of it. Sometimes you hit it lucky, you know, if you're persistent and you really want it, you know, I think that's the whole thing. Yeah.
Well, you've certainly been lucky. Well, you've been in theatre all your life. What age were you when you started musicals? It was
when I was about,
it must have been about
9.
12.
Nine, actually. Yeah, I was in a production of Pinocchio in the old Lyric Theater. They tore that down. The Eaton stands there now. It was a beautiful theater. I could kill whoever did that. It was gorgeous. It was like a mini Orpheum, and they tore it down. But it was a lovely old theater.
So were you singing or doing the...
I was actually dancing in that. I was a whirlwind. That was a lot of fun.
Did you dance? I know you
I
sang
did as
in
a, as a child, you know, we all took dancing, tap, right, singing. Right. It was sort of, everybody seemed to take it in those days. And so a little bit of everything.
But you're saying it's not your forte?
No. I never say die, though. I haven't tried it completely yet, so no. But it's not. Singing, definitely.
Right. Okay, let's get back to your studio for a moment. So you're open to all levels, beginner to advanced, and all ages.
Yes.
And you've got quite a few people. Can you give us a number?
Well, I would say we have an average of 150 people go through the studio per season.
Okay, and now, out of the 150, how many are doing it just for recreational purposes?
I'd say about a third.
A third?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you got two-thirds who are serious.
Pretty serious, yeah.
How many of those will go on to do professional work?
About another third.
Another third?
Yeah. Several, as I say, quite a few of them have. Out of the studio, 5 people were cast for Charlottetown last summer. So that was a good record, actually.
Right. Can you predict when a student comes in the early stages that, yes, this one is going to go
yes,
on?
Yes, because you can. They have a focus and determination, a lot of them, and talent, of course.
Yeah. Is there such a thing as star quality?
Definitely. There's a couple of people I can think of who have a lot of charisma, and I know that someday they are going to be famous, for sure.
So we look forward to seeing more fame and talent coming out of singing and dancing and acting studio.
We hope so.
Coached by Pat Waldron, and we'll look for that musical. We'll
look
for Weathering
good directors.
Heights.
Oh, sure.
And the surprise
Just
one.
Keep looking.
Okay, keep up the good work, Pat. And the energy. Don't let that grandson run you down.
No,
now.
No, I never will.
And thanks for taking time out from your studio to come
and
chat with us.
It's great.
I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank Andersons for providing this lovely setting for the interviews. For Contact, I'm Gloria Creighton. Please join us next time.